Oh, they can hear us?
Yeah.
Okay,
Okay,
cool.
they can hear me now. Ladies and gentlemen, and all the fantastic flavors of human being in between, welcome to the Pirate 101 Developer Q&A stream. I'm your community manager, Hocules, the son of Zeus. I'm joined by an intrepid crew. Dom, would you like to introduce yourself?
I'm Dominic, also known as Stormbringer in the community, Pirate 101 and Wizard 101 designer.
Gosh darn right you are. And we have another excellent example of what it means to be a human being. It's Andrew.
Yeah, hey, I'm Andrew Ream. I'm a senior game designer at King's Isle. I almost said Gamigo there, but
you know, give yourself the promotion.
Yeah, I'm senior game designer on Pirate 101.
You legally have to increase your salary if you do.
Yeah, but yeah. So I don't know if I have a community name. I've been pretty quiet this last year. So just doing stuff in the background.
Been pretty quiet developing all of those updates.
Oh yeah.
Most notably, Sinbad Part 3. In my opinion, thanks to both Andrew and Dom for working on the updates in the past year and working on updates for the year of our gamers 2024. Ooh, Pirate 101's we got some good things coming, y'all.
We got a lot. Yeah, we've got a lot of stuff planned. Mainly, so last year was kind of like a year of like learning. So let's take the game and kind of, you know, it was a newer team. Let's figure out how to create content for it. And so we've gotten a lot better at that this over the course of last year. We know what we can and can't do. So we're going to be looking for like places to kind of improve the game and hopefully, you know, bring more people into play. So it'll be great.
Andrew does need a character to embody. Chat, y'all should work on that one. The agenda for today's Daddy stream Blue is pretty simple. I'll be playing through a new character on the best video game in the known universe. While y'all go ahead and chit chat with a couple of fantastic developers. Got 2 hours slated for this. We might run out of steam at 90 minutes just because it's Friday. We've been working all week. Boy howdy. So don't be surprised if we have to cut early. Also, I have a tummy ache and I've been pounding Tums. So let's get it started. Go ahead. Developers are watching the chat for questions, and Hocules is about to flex his speedrun abilities.
What are you most proud of from your work on Pirate so far? So I can start by answering kind of this. It was fun kind of coming into a project that you've not worked on and kind of learning content that had been worked on by people like 10 years ago. So it's always interesting to kind of see how stuff is set up and whatnot. But from last year, one of the things I was really excited to get into, and I believe it was kind of a community suggestion, something we wanted to do for a while, but it was also something that someone posted on Twitter, was stagecoaches. I really liked that. That was really fun. It was quick and easy, you know, and it wins a lot of, you know, players enjoy that stuff. So I always like it when we can get kind of a small thing like that in. That was one of the things that's most memorable. Like, yeah, the content from last year, which is great. But kind of like doing those small little fixes is always a fun thing to kind of get in when you can quickly.
I'm proud that we were able to expand the content as much as we did. And in terms of particular things, a minor thing that I'm really happy about was the little effect that you get for beating the floating Dutchman a certain number of times, the pestilence effect. Because I was like, we need something that to make this like a special kind of boss. So I was looking, I'm like, we've done batch effects before. How do we do the Nef5? So I had to like reverse engineer it and then got that. And I was like, the pestilence effect is pretty iconic for the floating Dutchman. So I was pretty happy I was able to get that in. And that's like a small thing, a minor thing, but that's one thing I'm really proud of.
I kind of want to answer this one, but I can't give a good answer. So someone asked, when will there be another world added? So the scope of the Pirate team is not super big. So we have to kind of like take what we can get from from in the development space. So we reuse a lot of stuff, of course. Like, that's just going to be, you know, the size of Pirate is right now. The hope is, you know, maybe someday if we grow the team, if Pirates are doing better, like maybe we could do something like a world. But we're gonna be, you know, going and exploring maybe some new spaces within Pirate that we can take or use from you know, Wizard or that's already there, to kind of try to create interesting episodic content. I think that's been working well last year. So we kind of would hope to continue that. But I mean, I would love to make a new world. That's always great. That'd be awesome. We just need to get more players in to see if we can do that.
To go more in depth in that, like Pirate 101's big thing that we want to try to do is expand the player base, because once you expand the player base, then everything else follows from that. So we're looking at ways to improve the front funnel. We're looking at ways to possibly do win backs, all sorts of different metrics we're looking at to try and see, hey, how can we like bring this game back up to a really good population so that we can go to the like Amigo or whatever and be like, hey, Pirate 101 has a huge population now. We need more content. We would love to expand the team and stuff like that. We can make a case for it. But first things first, we need to expand the player population. So that's what we're focusing on coming into the new year. Stuff like Sinbad Part 2 and Part 3 are really important and really cool because that's to feed the players who are already there. But we also want to try stuff to bring in new players or bring in players who have lapsed, who've left the game and who are like perhaps more curious about, hey, what's Pirate doing now? Is Pirate still going on? Maybe I want to come back, and we want to figure out ways to win those people back as well.
Yeah, can I just say that Haku is speeding through this tutorial stuff so fast, and it's like triggering me, having tried to work a little bit on this tutorial last year. It's just like, you're already at the Trongies, okay.
I participated with the speedrunners a fair bit, yeah, in preparation for some speedrunning events,
and right,
I theoretically learned how to speedrun, but the run that I'm doing right now would have been reset so fast. But I appreciate people in chat recognizing that I'm attempting to speedrun. I forgot. These splits are going to be horrible, guys. We're not making the leaderboard. So a fair few people are recognizing that y'all said growing the player base is something important, and you know, more players, yeah, more resources, more content. Can we talk to any specifics about our plans of action for growing the player base besides the ads that we're running, which we are running cool ads again?
Well, right now we're focused on getting our analytics up pretty much because we want to analyze, hey, where are players coming in? Where are they coming in from? Where do they tend to lapse in questing? What systems maybe need to be improved in the beginning of the game? Like, if, for example, like, let's say we saw like 90% of players are passing through this quest, but then at a certain quest or a certain point in the game, like 50% drop off. That would be something you'd want to fix so that more players can continue cycling in through the game and stuff like that. So really we're focused on improving our analytics so we can get that data that we need, and then once we get the analytics that we need, we'll be able to focus our efforts more on,
yeah,
hey, these are the specific areas we need to improve on.
Okay.
And so we're also,
yeah, it's like, yeah, it's like a improve the experience so that when you start pulling a bunch of people in, they're more likely to stay and have fun.
Yeah. Right. Yeah. We're also looking at other products out in the same design space to see how they generated new population increases. To just kind of get more players in. We've got a few ideas, nothing we want to probably shed light on just now, but we are currently in the process of kind of doing these chats because this is the time of year we need to plan out to do it for the rest of the year. If anyone ever has any feedback at all of a ways to improve the game, you can always send them to Hocules. He's always listening and there, and we'll usually come over and talk to us about most situations that come up.
Yeah, I am.
Oculus is really good about that. Like, if players are pointing out, like, hey, this companion might need buffed, or this might need fixing, or something might be, there's some way you can improve on it, Oculus will get that feedback and get it to us. And
yeah, I get his bugs all the time from the players, and he's like, directed to me. And then I'm like, this is a bug for Dom, so I'm going to redirect this back to him. Thank you.
Yeah, I absolutely love, because y'all are the subject matter experts, and I'm not talking to the developers. I'm talking to the community. Y'all are the subject matter experts. And hearing y'all's opinions, I have received pages of documents, and a fair number of those pages have gone on to the developers. So y'all are good at knowing what the game is, where it is, and where it could go. I promise I'm listening. I lurk in so many Discords. It is creepy how many places I'm like, what you guys doing? What you guys talking about? Okay, neat. Noted.
I mean, you do it so that I don't have to, and I can focus on, you know, yeah. We can focus on making content. So it's been good.
Precisely.
Let's see. Let's find something else.
And to protect the devs from the madness that is the internet.
I saw a question that's, are there any plans to make all companions similar, like everyone could be a Peter Quinn? And actually, we're evaluating the companion system and we're looking into ways to improve it. But right now, and of course, never say never because plans change and objectives change. But at the moment, we're actually looking to differentiate companions more. Like, we want companions to fit certain niches. So we don't want every companion to just be Peter Quinn. Maybe we want big bruiser type companions like Peter Quinn, but maybe we want more defensive type companions like Ratbeard. Maybe we want different types of musketeer companions. Do we want Overwatch 5 companions that will keep melee units away? Maybe we want anti-musketeers like quick draw, burst fire, all that. So we're actually looking to differentiate the companions so that players know, like, hey, if I want to go into a particular play style or I want to accomplish different things on my different pirates, I can choose a companion set to match my playstyle.
To answer a couple questions really quick, we have unreleased companions. Are we going to release those with content that is deserving of the work that went behind those efforts? Like, gold promotions are neat. But if we're sitting on unused content, we'd rather use that to make
it
proper stuff.
Yeah, it's a very narrative-focused game, so it needs to make kind of some narrative sense to make it feel rewarding to some degree. And so we would like to pair that stuff with narrative so that applies to it.
And do we have... someone asked... are there any worries that Pirate might stop receiving support and or shutting down if there isn't an upward trend in the player base this year?
I can answer and then I can say something.
Yeah, we have goals, and we are eyebrow raisingly like effective at getting close to those goals this past year. So no one needs to worry about Pirate shutting down anytime soon.
Yeah. Pirate has improved quite a bit. I've been in and out of King's Isle for a while now. And I remember Pirate when it was, you know, not doing so well a couple of years ago. And it definitely, over the last year, we've kind of grown and done much better because of the community. Because the community stuck with it. And we started getting some content updates to them. And we have people now who can champion them. You know, I can't say exactly how big the team size is. I saw that was another question. It's a small team, but we are able to get resources to be making content again, which is great. And as long as we're making content and players are enjoying it and we have, you know, maybe some more uptick, the game will get bigger or it'll stay alive. But it is in this industry, we especially, you know, being where we are, like, it has been a pretty... couple years ago, I wouldn't have thought it was still around, but this game sticks. It stays, and it's mainly because of the community, because they're just really dedicated to it. And I'm hoping we can reward those PvP players to, you know, keep them happy.
And going back to community, like, the feedback is super important. And one thing I'm proud of that we did last year is we had released a poll that, hey, which type of content do you prefer? Do you prefer Dreadnoughts? Do you prefer Skeleton Key? bosses do you prefer, vortexes do you prefer, dungeons? And I think we hit literally every option on the list of things of what do players prefer. So we're looking at ways to expand our content with what we can do. And as some players are pointing out, is the story continuing? The story is definitely continuing. Sinbad quest line is now part of the main storyline, and that's the way we're going to continue. And while we may not have the resources to do a full world, we definitely want to expand the story in smaller episodic like content, like Sinbad 2 and 3.
Yeah, last year we were kind of looking at it like we're making the side content, but like, you know, we don't know if we'll be able to ever, like, you know, fully develop that story further. So we just made the choice, no, we should just be doing, you know, with the size of our team, we should just be doing story stuff, like mainline. So from now on, you know, we're just doing mainline stuff until we can potentially get bigger, hopefully. So that's why we kind of made that decision to switch to some degree. And that's why we're, you know, that's why everything from now on that we're making is going to be mainline stuff. For now, but we have a lot of quality of life choice. Like I saw those like balance changes, quality of life, companion stuff. Yeah, we are trying to plan some stuff. Mainly, you know, we're gonna choose and pick which feature is best for the game's health. So, you know, we can't say what we're gonna be doing for this year, but it's gonna be probably a bit of what we did last year, similar to that.
And we have said this publicly. If y'all are fans of the main storyline for Pirate 101, that's so weird, you might be. We are continuing it with a significant weight this year. Eh? Game go burr.
Are there plans to convince 5x max pirates to play through the game again? Do you mean like players who have all the classes of pirates to play through the game again?
I think they mean people with accounts that have a full suite of max pirates.
Mm. So we're currently talking about maybe doing something to help those players, but nothing concrete yet. We're just still like we're still in the planning stuff for this year. So we've got a lot of stuff that we've decided we're going to definitely do, but there are some I want to address some of the issues like that. Like I want to give players enough, you know, space to be able to play through the game again, or some kind of solution to be able to experience the story a second time. That is pie in the sky big stuff. So we might, you know, we have to see what our resources are. But, you know, I'm always open to hearing what players want.
Some folks are asking about the new voice actors. What I can say is that Bonnie Ann's new voice actor, as far as I know, sorry, Mark Packard, if I'm getting this wrong, as far as I know, is here to stay. We had to replace her. Much, much love to the previous voice actor. We love her so much. But when you live on the other side of the world, it makes doing things a lot more difficult, especially getting people into a studio in America. There has been a lot of talk about companions, some of the like F-minus tier companions getting slight reworks. We did do some work with companions that had that were essentially broken. Do we have any public plans to do companion reworks this year?
I know I plan on doing companion reworks. To what extent we will be able to do that is still to be determined. But yes, like I said, we're looking at the companion system as a whole.
Mm-hmm.
Those companions are a key part of Pirate 101. So we want to make sure that system is as engaging and as fun for the players as we can possibly make it.
I think it's also fair for everyone to know when developers when the developers for Pirate 101 sit down in meetings and talk about, all right, what are we doing in 2024? The whiteboard gets chock full of ideas that I'm seeing parroted across the community by far. The biggest question isn't what to do, it's what can we do. And unfortunately, those two lists are very different. A lot of y'all have very passionate and very accurate and good ideas, but for whatever reasons, resources, the way the game is coded, it's just...
Yeah. Game development in general was kind of a weird thing, because you could look at something and think it's like very easy to implement, or it could be easy to implement in another engine or another, you know, type of game. And then you actually peel back the layers of the onion and you realize, oh, this is insane. Like, this is very complex.
Companion skins. That's one that a lot of people have said. Companion skins, and all of us go, yeah, we'd love to. And then we look at the code base and the UI required and the tech required, and it's like, oh.
Yeah. Oh. Literally one of the first conversations I had with one of the other designers on the project was like, because he had wanted to do companion skins forever. I come from a game that's like our bread and butter. I come from Trove. So like I was like, yeah, let's do it. Let's do companion skins. And they're like, oh, it's like, that's much more complicated than we had hoped. But it's like on the board of like, I definitely want to do this someday. Like it's great for, you know, the health of the product. It's great for players to express like the way they look, but it's a big, it's a lot of stuff involved in making that system work. Like, it's a lot of departments it hits. So I'm going to put it back on my list of like, maybe look into this year, depending on skins. We'll talk to that designer about it more.
There were no resource limitations preventing you from adding a new world. What would you be most excited to work on?
What world?
Yeah.
I think, like, me personally, I've been a Part 101 player for a while, so there's been a Polaris Stormgate in Valencia for forever. But that I'd be super excited to work on something like that. I'd be super excited to work on something like Darkmoor. Like, we have Darkmoor ships in Cool Ranch, and we've never visited there, and we know the Duck of Death got his powers from Darkmoor. That'd be cool to visit that, but... any kind of like world and stuff like that, we'd have to go through writing, of course, and we have amazing writers, and you guys know Sam and you love Sam, so Sam will be the one who directs the story there, and we're enthusiastic to work in whatever world the writers decide, hey, this is where we want to take the story and whatnot. So
yeah,
I would love, like I said, I would love to work in Polaris Darkmoor, depending on what, but any world really. Pirate in general would be amazing.
I agree on the Darkmoor sentiment, because it's something I think a lot of the team has wanted to do for a while. I think it'd be super cool. I like spooky stuff, and I think it's cool. We're going to a place soon that I'm really excited about, but I can't talk about. But in general, Darkmoor would be sick. That'd be awesome. But right now, no plans for it.
I'm on the team of cute penguins. Get the cute penguins.
I saw Iwan first place was asking a question about Witch Doctors hitting through spells. I'm not sure what you mean. Can you rephrase that?
Was the release of Pirate 101 to Steam a success? Depends on how you define a success. If adding players and increasing revenue is success, then it is success.
I saw a great hit at Trove's Mastery System, and I love it. So I have to bring that up because I worked on Trove. Andrew, would you ever consider bringing something like Trove's Mastery System to Pirate 101? It'd be awesome to be able to collect gear and weapons. I mean, it's a cool system because the Mastery System in Trove specifically, it tracks what styles you have for your weapons, essentially what items you've unlocked, and you get different point systems based off of that. I like it. It's fun. It'd be cool to have something similar to that where you could actively see your collection of stuff you've already unlocked. I don't know if we could physically do it in Pirate right now. We would need a lot of tech. But you know, that system is a mixed bag. It's really cool for the player base, but it can be kind of a nightmare working for a developer, just because it's a point system that keeps going up and hasn't really no cap. So you kind of get stuck into having to always deal with it. But I like that there's a dig at Trove here that made me very happy.
Okay, I understand. I won first place. I was reading it as I won't first place for some reason. I was like, what? Anyway, I won first place. This question I understand now. He was saying that previously in Pirate 101, when Witch Doctors used their spell powers, they were able to trigger their like Mojo Echoes, like Jobu's Rising and all that. They were able to trigger their epics off of spells. Like, when a big change like that is made to a system, we won't necessarily want to revert it until we understand why that change was made. So I'd probably want to talk to the combat designer, who was probably Ratbeard at the time, and understand why he changed it that way. Or if it was another designer, we could also find out like that. Like, I don't know who made that decision, but we'd want to look back into why that decision was made, because there might be a very good reason why that decision was made before we just want to revert it and be like, hey, everyone gets free Mojo Echoes. And then, not saying this would make Witch Doctor overpowered or whatever, because I understand most players view the Witch Doctor class as probably one of the weaker ones, but we'd want to look back at that decision, the design decision around that, before we make any kind of sweeping changes like that.
You know what'd be a fantastic idea? I just got the world record for tutorial. I didn't. That was terrible. But if folks want to go fight the developer hacked account Fairmax, if people in chat want to do that, we can do that instead of the main quest line. And anyway, please, gentlemen, please continue.
Because I like stagecoaches, I'll answer this. So someone says, are there any plans to add a stagecoach to Skull Mountain or make transporter a free? This is mainly kind of, so you can go both ways of this. Yeah, you can put a stagecoach in there, but I would worry about, you know, we're looking to definitely enhance the first time user, the Fatui, first time user experience. There's the war. I think coming from it, just thinking about it, if you put a stagecoach in there right away, you definitely have to like lock it out to players, because it could be confusing just to be able to kind of travel one. They definitely need achievements to get it. Stagecoach, there's nothing planned currently for new stagecoaches, but it's definitely something I'm actively talking about potentially doing elsewhere at different zones. It would have to make sense to do it at Skull Island. And I think right now I would prefer to put it somewhere else if we were going to do another one. So
another thing is, we have to make other considerations, such as like segmentation of the player population.
Yep.
Like putting a stagecoach in Skull Island, maybe necessarily we don't want to do that because we want players playing together. Because Pirate 101 already has a lot of segmentation. Like, you have the commons area, then you have the dock, and then you have the skyway, and the players in those different areas cannot interact with each other. So the player base is already segmented.
Yeah.
So do we necessarily want more segmentation in the early area of the games, especially if we're bringing in more and more players? For an MMO type game,
yeah, we
typically want players to be able to interact with each other, to be able to form those social connections and those bonds. So while it's a great thing for probably like older players who are like playing a new character or whatever, who've already gone through this content and want to go through it faster, we also have to consider, hey, how might this affect other things? Like, if there's a brand new player coming in and everybody's just using the stagecoach and he sees an empty common area because seeing anyone in the skyways because no one's using the skyways or whatever, what are they going to think? Like, they're going to think like, oh, no one's actually playing this game. Am I alone here?
Which is a huge problem. We can see the early game kind of like players coming into the game and where they drop off, what missions. We're trying to make changes to Fatui to fix that and to fix those early drop-off points. Dom's exactly right. If we put kind of like more solutions in to kind of traverse that early section, players, it might have a negative effect.
And like I said, we're not saying never or we're not saying no, but we just have to evaluate all the potential impacts before we make some kind of change like that.
Need to have good reasons and rules, yeah.
Yeah. Like, for Mushu, it made sense. There's a late area world, and it's pretty segmented, and there's a lot of key points that players want to go to. for Skull Island, we'd really have to consider it like this is an early world. There's a lot of new players. How do we want to direct those players, so to speak? And maybe more teleports and more stagecoaches is the answer, but we'd want to evaluate it first to make sure that we don't make a mistake, pretty much.
I skipped the puppet show, you guys.
Oh, bummer. Just when someone was asking, what's your favorite puppet show?
Yeah. By the way, the puppet shows are my favorite part about this game. When I was doing the research for my interview almost 2 years ago, I was playing the game and I got to the puppet shows. And in my notes, I just wrote, hee hee, puppet shows.
You know, they're really unique for the product. Like, there's just not a lot of that kind of stuff. Like, that's drastically different out in the MMO world. I really love the intro one, just because of I like how they do class selection a lot.
Oh yeah.
I wish you explained maybe a little more, but I think it is great. So yeah, that's probably what I enjoy the most.
I saw a question, how hard is it to port stuff from Wizard 101 into Pirate? It's actually more difficult than you would think. Like, some things we can port fairly easily, quote unquote, but there's other things that even though it's on the same engine or whatever, the way the games were programmed, Wizard and Pirate, it makes transferring much more complicated. Like, we were thinking about transferring a certain system, and we thought it would be super easy to transfer the system because it's like, hey, this works in Wizard, this will be super easy to port over to Pirate. And then it ended up taking a lot of tech time, a lot of research, and we weren't able to do it necessarily. So the answer is, it's a lot more complicated than you would think for certain things. For some things, it's easy. But for bigger systems, like certain things, like, let's say, the crafting system or whatever, like, you couldn't necessarily just port that from Wizard into Pirate.
Yeah, we actively want to make the games, you know, in the background on our development side similar, because it will lead us to be able to implement stuff faster, be able to use shared resources better. So we are trending towards that now internally, but you have to think about it, like, Pirate is a game that had a lot of development, then slowed because it didn't do as well, and then is now picking up again. Meanwhile, Wizard kept, like, it's always done well. So Wizard's always gonna get, you know, it's getting updates periodically in the background. So it's been a fun thing over the last year to compare, you know, the Wizard's kind of dev processes versus Pirates, and how can we, you know, take from each other, because they might take some stuff from us or we might take stuff from them. Like, the UI stuff is all completely, like, it's split on Pirate between two different systems, whereas Wizard's all one system. So it's like how are we doing this different? How can we improve it so that we can then, you know, make stuff faster? There are some things that are easy to port over, but then there are some things that just won't work, or we don't know if they'll work until we try. So.
And I saw one of our animators say, laughing animator, when they were porting stuff from Wizard to Pirate. So, yeah.
That's another thing. Yeah. Wizard doesn't have as many animations as Pirate does. Pirate has a lot more animations. So they have to always go and add in extras and change how they work. So it's just two different design philosophies at the time when they set up the game.
Right. For even something like an attack, a wizard has like a wand attack, and it's a natural cast or a certain type of weapon cast, whereas pirates have to have a stance, you have to have a direction you're facing, you have to have different types of ways you move, for different types of weapons, all that stuff.
All right, it's time to PvP with the maximum fair account that I have. Oh, this account is so much fun. I wish there was a way for us to create custom encounters to drop for the community. Since we can't do that, I have taken This took me a few hours to do, but I made an account who has the maximum stats possible for our engine. Which, speaking of our engine, fun fact about our game engine, there are, please don't take this out of context, it's contextually in this one sentence a silly little thing. Our game engine has 5 genders in it: boy, girl, small, medium, and large. Tag yourself, I'm large. So this character has literally everything applied to it. If you can beat this character, then you can face any challenge that Pirate 101 has to throw at you.
Don't offer anything, because they'll find some weird way to beat it.
Oh yeah.
Yeah. What are your long and short term plans for pets in Pirate 101? Someone asked. So pets kind of go into kind of a similar container as like companions of like, we're actively looking at all these systems to see how we can improve them. We would like to do something, but currently we are not really working on pet systems right now. That's just something we're just not kind of like pursuing. But we're open to it. We're talking about, you know, potential, like, what are we going to do the rest of the year? So, you know, if there's enough call for pets and it has a good enough impact on the game, then yeah, we'll do something with it. Pets don't necessarily drive new players into the game. So if our drive is to increase population, that might not be the best use of our resources. But, you know, we are actively listening to the community. It's something that has come up a couple times in the meetings and similar scopes to companions. I just think we would probably do a companion thing before a pet thing. Maybe. That's just my personal opinion, but maybe I'm wrong. But
yeah, but one way I like thinking about it is, like, let's say you're a player that's lost from the game and you're receiving an email from King's Isle that's trying to attract you back to the game. And the email is like, the pet system is now faster and you haven't played the game for several years or whatever. Are you likely to come back because, oh, pet trading times are faster? Probably not. If we improve something for, like, hey, the first time user experience is really better, or this new mechanic is in, or we introduce this new thing or whatever, then you're much more likely to attract either players who have lapsed or new players. So we have to think about that too. And like I said, with infinite resources and with a much larger team, we'd love to hit like all these hot button topics like as soon as possible. But right now we kind of have to focus on, like I said, we really want to focus on expanding the player population. Because once that happens, then we can start going into more.
Yeah, we can hire additional team members. We can, you know, grow in size. We just have to make it, you know, a reasonable, like, give our company a reason to increase the size of the team. And that would be, you know, increased population, increased spending on the game. So I think, you know, we're looking at a lot of different ways to potentially do that. I know a lot of people have mentioned in this chat about, you know, moving the paywall. That's one thing we've been talking about moving the paywall for a while. So that's potentially one solution, or making more, you know, free to play weekends or something is something we're talking about in the background. So any suggestions, we're always happy to hear. So we're gonna, you know, figure out what we want to do and then do it to hopefully improve the game.
I have a note from marketing that says Steam launch was a big success. Yay.
Will Pirate 101 crafting be a thing? So I come from Trove, and crafting's everything in Trove. And so I want it to be a thing, but it's something that, you know, we're in the early stages of talking about. So I would like that. That'd be awesome. You can do a lot of different stuff with the crafting system. But right now, like, yeah, it's something we've thought about. It's just, we'd have to implement it. Like Dom said, we can't just port the crafting system over from Wizard necessarily. We would have to do it either a new way or figure out a way that the Wizard system would work properly in Pirate.
So this is a comment. This is a sentiment I've seen across a fair few number of people. When the companions die, Miracle Mitch is kind of a bummer.
Yeah, we're open to reevaluating Miracle Mitch. It typically doesn't hit early players as much because your companion dies and then your companion revives in like a minute or two. But when you're a max level player, it takes hours, and then players go to Miracle Mitch and they spend a lot of gold and whatnot. So it's definitely something we'd definitely want to look at and see if it was, because it, when Miracle Mitch was designed, there was a certain goal in mind, a certain behavior, and we'd want to look and see, hey, did this actually entice the type of behavior we expected it to, or did it have effects that we didn't expect it to? And if it did, had effects, it didn't meet the goal and it has negative effects, we'd change it.
What realm is Hocules in?
I think Gandry? In the middle of a fight, though. Oh, hey, it's Kyle Icewielder in the chat. The community manager for Wizard 101. A legend, a scholar, a gentleman, and above all else, a silly goose. Miracle Mitch finally getting publicly executed. Yeah, you know what? Let's just go delete it from the game.
We have the power, right? We can do that. Just remove someone, yeah.
Let's get them out. The authority.
Yeah, let's ban someone.
And I saw a question about ship combat, and I've said it before, but that would be one of the systems like I'd most like to change. Yeah. Because right now, ship combat, I don't think is fun. A lot of people don't think it's fun. And ships in general in a pirate game are a big part of like the pirate aesthetic and the pirate. Like, you look at any other type of pirate game and like ships are a big part of it. So we'd love to either revamp that system entirely. Mm-hmm. And just make it like fun and an actual like engaging system for the player. And we're looking at different ways, like, hey, if we can't revamp it, would we maybe want to remove the system or push it back to a further level? Because let's say a new player comes in, they're just learning Pirate 101's combat system, and then all of a sudden they're pushed into ship, right into the tutorial, they're pushed into ship combat, which is an entirely different combat system. And then they go back to regular combat and they go back to ship combat. Is that necessarily the experience for players? Probably not, but ship combat, I would love to just revamp to make it like actually like fun and engaging, because I think like I said, the whole pirate aesthetic, ships in general are a big part of it. So if we could get our ship combat actually fun and working, I think that would be a huge boon for pirate.
Literally my first week of working on pirate, everyone was telling me, are you gonna fix ship combat? So yeah, it's something I was dreaming about it over the winter break of like, what are the ways we potentially fix it? Someone told me like they had a solution. I was like, oh, maybe we could do that. And then I came back and we're like, well, maybe we should, you know, pause it. I do know that it causes a lot of problems early on with new users. Yeah, I think it is part of the reason why we have a little bit of drop off at the beginning. So it may be, yeah, something we need to push back, but or at least make more optional in a way at the beginning of the game. But it should be serving the purpose of it is a big cool feature in the game because it brings players in, or yeah, we should kill it like that, or not kill it, but like, you know, push it off the side. But I would hope to, you know, us to develop a way to make it more fun and more engaging like that. That's definitely something that I've wanted to fix since the beginning for sure.
Yeah, because, you know, it's a pirate video game. Gotta have good ship comp.
Yep.
Andrew, what is your biggest task you had to face with Pirate 101? I've changed kind of gears in how I am as a developer from coming off of a game that's mostly systems heavy. So that was a big change this year of doing more content stuff. A lot of pirate is lost knowledge. So it's a lot of looking at the game and seeing, okay, how was this made this way? Who is the person who worked on this? And then you look at the person and they've been gone from the company for years. That's always kind of a fun thing to backtrack and figure out, like, why was this designed? Why did they choose to make it this way? So that's always kind of a challenge. But, you know, we're a scrappy team, so we can usually duct tape something together to make it fun. We are learning new ways of implementing content that I'm very proud of, and taking a lot from Wizard, because the Wizard devs over there are, you know, they're great. A lot of them have been there for years, or a lot of them are just real, like, you know, they're real snappy when it comes to working on this stuff, especially implementing new content. So I've had a real joy of, like, working with them and learning from them last year. I don't name names on streams, but they've been great. I don't want out anybody.
Did you know that Pirate 101 has a TikTok? Did you know that the silly gooses behind the best video game of all time have a TikTok now? That's all. That's it.
Is there any more insight into what is on that TikTok? Silly
content.
Stuff? Content?
Yep.
Content.
Content.
Good
I like
content.
It. Good.
Yes, I can also spam the Discord.
I just think TikTok's Vine, so that shows how old I am.
TikTok is Vine. Vine died too soon. Rip Vine. Gone.
I miss Vine. Forgotten. All right.
Any plans on buffing drop rates for things like Moo or Dread?
I'm assuming you're talking the original Dread.
Yeah.
Yeah, the whole loot system has to be evaluated. I've been making the loot drops a lot better for the newer content, but we need to go back in general and look at all the old content and figure out, like Andrew said, there's a lot of lost knowledge there. So we have to go back and look at, like, some of the drop rates. Like, some of the drop rates I've looked at old content is, like, ridiculously low. So, yeah, we'd love to fix it to where players feel rewarded for doing the content.
Yeah, I would say no specifics for, like, specific items right now, but, like, definitely, yeah, like Tom's saying, like, I think we're a little softer touch with some things. Granted, you know, we can't make everything super easy to acquire, especially if it's, like, a scenario where, you know, we need sweat equity, we need a way of, like, getting players to kind of keep engaging in the game. So maybe in the future there'll be new solutions to that, like new ways of grinding that'll be more interesting. Like coming from Trove, yeah, that's something I definitely would want to do. But yeah, we'll see. I think we've gotten better the last year of, like, making the drop rates not as, like, terrible.
And we also take a lot of knowledge we learn from, like, Wizard 101 and can apply it to Pirate, like. Yep. Our new loot system in Wallaroo is really popular with the players, so we'd obviously be like, okay, what's working with this loot system, and can we bring that into, like, Pirate?
Yeah. And we have all the everyone sits next to each other, so we just, like, you know, go to the economy designer on that and be like, hey, how can we implement this on Pirate for, like, a new section content's coming out? How can we kind of mimic what you all are doing to make it more enjoyable for the Pirate people?
Anything with packs and stuff would be a product question, which none of us are product designers, so I wouldn't want to speak on that.
Yeah, we have some influence and stuff with packs, but ultimately, yeah, product is kind of separate. So we would talk to them. One of the designers who does a lot of work on stuff is on the product team. So, you know, we have a very good back and forth with him. So we can talk to him about it. But yeah, we mostly focus on content and system stuff.
Pity system, we've talked about that. We also, I can't talk about the math we did, because if you reverse engineer the math, then you'd be able to find, but I did go through the math with a couple of leads on the Pirate team about, hey, so if you want all of the Imperial items from Moo, here's the number of hundreds of hours you need to statistically...
You should send me these items. You haven't sent them to me.
That's fair. Here's the statistical... I'll just tell you the number in our side
I'll
chat.
Out you right now about that.
Yeah. The statistical number of hours for, on average, assuming average luck, you need to obtain all of those items. And, like, some video games, like... There are a lot of video games that would be happy to get a tenth of that as a playtime. So there are voices in the community and inside the team of, hey, so these drop rates. Yeah, the side chat is side chatting. Yeah, there are voices inside the team and in the community saying, hey, these drop rates are a little.
Yeah, it just depends on the like, it depends on the value of the item. So you know, you can have some solutions where it's like if something gives you like a huge boost to your strength, you should, most players probably grind for it some bit. Or if it's something like you know, that unlocks a permanent thing, like in Trove, we would do classes. Classes can be purchased or unlocked. We want players to purchase it because that makes the game more healthy. The grind for those was insane, just because it needed to be, just because we need to either have you, you know, engage in the systems and, you know, get it the long way, or purchase it because we need the equity to stay afloat. So it's kind of like, you have to kind of look at it like that. Like what is the value of this item? If it's like a regular like piece of gear, that maybe it's a bit too long. So maybe we need to adjust it going forward. I would hope, you know, going forward, we're I think being a little more soft on stuff, so we wouldn't be that bad. But we'll look at it. Keep a note. Talk to me about it later, Chris.
Heard. So as with the companions that are out, that are made but not released, there are a couple of items that players are keen to see hit the game. Namely, Kane's Robes, or Goritiz's Mantle, I think it's called, and Lopan's Mustache. What do we got to do to get those in the games, boys? Those are the two best looking items that have hit Pirate 101. That mustache is fire, guys. I want that in the video game. Give me.
DM me about it. We can talk about it.
Okay.
I think at one point we were doing something with Lopan's mustache. It sounds familiar. It sounds like familiar from a chat I had a while ago. Yeah, just DM me about it. We'll talk about it.
Okay.
We'll look at it. We're always looking for new items we can bring over that the players want to drive to get, especially if we're doing new content stuff. We want to, you know, find items that players will want to collect. So yeah. If anyone wants to send Chris item ideas from Wizard to bring over, or Chris, if you want to send me item ideas to bring over in Pirate, like, I'm always open to hear, so that we have something we can, you know, add in the game. That mustache sounds familiar. I'm sure we've had a meeting about that. It's going to go into something eventually.
Conversation about the paywall. We...
Yeah.
We share the same opinions about wanting to experiment with that.
Yeah.
And
we
may or may not be trying to do that in 2024.
We'll see. We need to talk about it. There needs to be a good enough justification for it to move. There needs to be, you know, it needs to, we have to look at the analytics to see if, like, will this affect us in a negative way? If it definitely seems like it'll affect us in a positive way, maybe we can move it. But it has been, you know, kind of like how the games have been set up for years. So It's worked well in Wizard. It makes more sense in Wizard. But, you know, it's something we need to have an in-depth conversation about. Everyone has their own opinions on it. We're literally having these talks now. So.
It makes the C-suite, like, heavy decision makers very nervous when you say, we'd like to tamper with the core monetization of this product.
It's one of those things that once you do it, depending on how you do it, you can't go back. So it's a big decision to make. It could be healthy for the game to move it, but it could also have a negative effect overall on the product. So you have to really, you know, justify a good reason to either remove it entirely or to push it back, or to, you know, maybe focus on doing like free weekends or something where it's like, you know, you have, you know, a free weekend. I know a lot of MMOs, I believe ESO does free weekends, and that's increased their population spikes. So it could be like maybe we could move towards doing that if we could physically do it. It's something we're talking about doing maybe. So we're keeping in mind. But if it seems like it won't be healthy to the game, we won't do it. Because we want the game to be as healthy as possible. We want the game to survive. Because, like, you know, not only is it, you know, our jobs to do that, but also it's like we don't want the community to be like disappointed in the product. We care, Chris. We care.
Heck yeah.
Yeah.
Okay, chat, let me hear your favorite parts of the updates from the last year, favorite parts of Sinbad, and the other updates besides, what was the companion that we, like, found was bugged and revived and people are using him again from this past year? The trash gear was pretty freaking stellar, I'm not gonna lie. Quincy Crisp, yeah, Quincy Crisp is alive again.
I'm sad. I missed. I literally went on vacation when all that trash gear stuff went live, but I'm sad about it. I worked so hard on that update, and then I was like, I'm out for a little while, and then I was like, oh yeah, everyone enjoyed it. I'm so happy, but yeah.
I've seen comments on Quincy and the Raja companion, and yeah, I worked on both of those. So, like I said, I'm looking at companions, and if we get feedback on like. Like there's certain, I have certain leeway to do certain things. Like I can't go in and I don't have the bandwidth to go in and like change every companion. But if I see a companion that I can make improvements to, I will be happy to do that.
Yeah, Dom is a workhorse. He splits his time between both pirate and wizard. So whenever we do get him over on the pirate side, it's like a blessing, and you know we get work done. It's really exciting. I like that someone commented that the fact that there are updates. Yeah, we're here. We're making updates. I'm glad we're getting stuff out. Someone said, Dom, we need to steal you away from Wiz. This is my literal. That's what I say all day.
At the time.
Yeah. let's get Dom over here more. Like, yeah, that's part of my day.
Heck yeah.
Dom, where are you at today? That's like I ask that once a week. Like where are you at this week?
Surprised you don't have a macro for it.
I should have like a live updated like percentage tracker of Dom to just say like, hey, what's where's Dom at? Which version of COBOL is open? Which version of our engine is open?
We need a Twitter account to give live updates of what Dom's working on.
Dom Watch 2024. Yeah.
When I was working at a summer camp, we had a camp director who was notoriously difficult to find. So one year I slipped a GPS tracker into his bag before the start of the year. And about halfway through the season, he was like, how do you keep knowing where I am? And I go, intuition.
And then crimes.
Yeah, he came over to me the next day, put it down on the table I was at, and he went, intuition, huh?
And I want to mention we have a lot of good designers on Wiz that we yank for pirate well. Like I don't know if they want to be mentioned on stream, but we have a particular world designer that like we have if there's any type of issue in pirate or we need a world fix or whatever, we'll just yank that person and be like, hey, we're stealing you from Wizard.
It's a shared effort, and it's like, you know, we try to get stuff where we can because we're a scrappy game. Like there are some games, you know, in development that are scrappy. They try to stay alive, and so that's kind of where we're at, and we're doing better to improve that to stay alive really well. But yeah, like we have our product designer is real great. I really appreciate what he does because not only does he do a lot of the product stuff, but he also helps us out immensely on the dev side. To get the gear and to like you know take stuff apart and try to reuse it in interesting ways. He's always coming up with cool stuff. So yeah, it's a huge effort by everyone. Like you know, depending on what game you work. I know that I'll go and talk to to one of the world builders on, or two of the world builders on Wiz all the time about, you know, how is this like set up in Wizard? And then we'll look at the pirate stuff and they'll be like, oh yeah, you don't have that option, but here's an interesting way to do it. So it's just really collaborative and great. And we all report back to the same boss, so it helps.
Yep.
Will we ever see a new Skyway? I mean, the answer is I would love to. That'd be awesome. Also, Skyways take up a ton of resources. They're very expensive to not only implement and build, like most worlds, but they also are really heavy on the engine stuff. We put that skeleton key into a vortex last year, and we thought it would be like an interesting way to kind of get something into a Skyway, and it turned out to be a nightmare to actually get the game running in there properly. So Skyways are kind of hit or miss right now, because they're just wildly big, and they take a bit of work. But I mean, you know, we never know. Maybe I'd be excited to do more Skyway stuff. Yeah. I think it's cool if we can get ship combat being really fun and good to play. Like, yeah, maybe we could do some kind of Skyway thing if we have the resources.
And Skyways take a lot of tech. They take a lot of art. They're drawing a lot of resources.
You know, that question makes me excited, but at the same time, like, man, it's probably not going to happen anytime soon unless like something drastic changes.
My day's going great. Thanks for asking.
I saw a question I can't answer, but I wanted to answer. So. seeing a couple of those. You know, there's the questions you don't want to answer. There's the questions you want to answer and can't. And then there's the questions that you pick out because it's an easy thing to say.
We ever see a companion gear system? One of the things you have to understand, if you want to make an entirely new system where the player receives enormous buffs and advantages, you have to balance that and give the enemy's enormous buffs and advantages, and at what point does combat become who can one-shot the other person first?
You have to rebalance the whole game, so.
Yeah. Well, Pirate 101 that sounds have a cool, battle pass.
But I think, yeah, it sounds cool, but you know, I think we could potentially put efforts into making companions more desirable in other ways, to be similar to what a gear system would require. I mean, the nice part about gear systems is they create more drive for the players, but it would be like, you know, we would need a whole nother designer probably to manage that. But it's a cool idea. I'll write it down, but I don't think anything will come of it.
I saw Mayo ask an interesting question, like, once the level cap goes up, will gear just be interesting for powers and stats? And that's a open question that we're actually evaluating now, because right now Pirate, a lot of players like just discount the stats on the gear entirely and just look at the item card, which makes sense because a lot of the player power in Pirate, unlike Wiz, comes from the character itself rather than the gear. So we were questioning if we want to change that or not, but it's an open question and it's a big question because part of the appeal of Pirate is that, hey, I can run gear from like level 35 if it has an interesting item card and it won't like necessarily negatively impact me competitively. So, and that's a pretty distinctive part of Pirate 101's combat system. So if we were to make any changes, it would have to, like I said, we're having conversations about it now, if we'd even want to do something like that, because it would be a drastic departure from how the power system that players are used to works.
Will we get a Hawk promotion? I mean, we want to do more promotion quests because the player base really wants those. It just needs to make sense in our schedule for to do more promotion quests. Promotion get quests are really, really just for like end game players who have collected a majority of those companions, specifically Hawk release. So, I mean, it'd be cool to do that. I don't know if we're going to do it right now, but it's something we're actually talking about, especially that character, because it is... You know, people like that guy for some reason. I don't know why, but you know, Hocules is apparently some cool dude. But but you know,
And I saw Red reaching this asking, leads into my other question, would we ever see a rework of Relent and Bladestorm to encourage more tactical builds over RNG ones? So any type of big change to the combat system like that would require both a lot of discussion and a lot of work. So would we see that anytime soon? Probably not. Would we be open to discussing it? Yes, because we are a tactical game. So I know RNG does have a place in tactical games. You can look at games like XCOM and stuff where, you know, you might miss your shot even though you have like 95%, but it's like it's a key aspect of the game to be able to manage that risk and stuff like that. So, like I said, we're evaluating all the systems in Pirate right now because we like I said, we want to be able to expand the game. We want to be able to pull in new players. We want to retain them, and we also want to be able to attract players who have lapsed from they've left the game. We want to bring them back in. So we're definitely looking at all those things, but any type of like big combat shifts like that, like I said, would take a lot of discussion and a lot of work before that would happen. Like we could technically just be like, okay, Relentless is 100% now, but what does that do to the combat system? How does that change the fights? Does that actually lead to a more fun experience? And a lot of times what players, or not necessarily players, what people think would lead to a more fun system would just break the game. I remember one time, like back in the day, like when I was a kid, I was playing Pokemon, and then my friend introduced like this program Action Replay, which was pretty much like a cheat for Pokemon at the time, and then it just like made my Pokemon super OP, and it just completely broke the game experience. Like I was like one-shotting everything, nothing could touch my Pokemon, and then the game just became unfun. So any type of big change to the combat system would really want to evaluate what are the effects that would have.
I get this one a lot. Will we ever step foot in El Dorado? So that's a narrative question more of facing. It makes sense to, if we can go there, like from a development standpoint. I mean, we want to continue the main story. So that's more of a question like for like, you know, the narrative lead for to answer that, potentially.
Sam Johnson, aka Blind Mew, will be on a stream. He'll be on a PvP tournament stream this month.
Yeah,
which I'm not sure why they asked for him specifically, but if you want to talk to Blind Mew, the narrative lead, he will be on a stream.
Yeah, I guess what I'm trying to say is we're continuing the main story, so you know if we end up there, we end up there. But it's mostly that's a narrative kind of decision. Like we are more of like the shepherds to get stuff into the game and be champions to help the game live healthily and stay alive. Like that's kind of more of our, at least that's what I was sold when I came over here, was like that's what you know you're going to be doing. So as for narrative decisions, we have some input I think now, and we're getting more I think, but ultimately it's like where does narrative want to take the story, if we can justify it. And I'll answer this world question again while I'm doing it. If we can justify, you know, building out somewhere new like El Dorado or building out a new world, then and we can get the team size, then yeah, that'd be great. But we need to be able to show that Pirate can have a population that can sustain that growth in content size. You know, we've talked about different solutions of like should we switch to doing a different type of content, like, but for now we're gonna, I think, stick with this episodic stuff. But you know, if anything for world stuff, it would be, you know, bringing things over from Wizard that we can, since that is an easy solution, and they kind of intermix with the story stuff because they're in the same universe. So that would be possibilities for the new world, but we need to make sure we show that we have a team size that can handle it. And right now we're pretty good with like what we're doing currently. But I hope that we'll be able to make more soon.
In terms of narrative, I trust in Sam and the writing team. They've done an awesome job. Pirate 101 has, I think, one of the most interesting stories in any game. So yeah, any type of narrative questions that you feel free to shoot the Sam and Sam story time. Sam does this thing called Sam story time where he'll like go over the plot of the world that we've built or that we're going to build, or and the beats and whatnot. And that's just an awesome experience. So Sam, I fully trust Sam's ability to drive
the narrative. Yeah, they're a really great writing team to work with, and to kind of they'll shoot for the stars, and but they're really good at taking feedback and working with. So it's been very enjoyable. Why are you freaking out, Hockeyleys? What's going on?
I played the Discord notification sound.
You know, when it comes to wizard assets, like, will more wizard assets be used as enemies and stuff in Pirate 101? You know, we I think should use them to some degree. We don't want to overuse stuff for sure. Like, we want to get unique stuff when we can. And we're still getting unique stuff when we can. But I think if we have this great pool of stuff just sitting there that we could potentially take and make cool content, yeah, we should. Like, we should totally use it. But there is always a question in people's mind, especially on the art side, of like, are we overusing this? Are we, you know, not giving enough unique things? And we always take that into judgment when we decide to pull something over or to make something more unique when we can. So that's the best I can answer that.
We've publicly talked about this. Folks are saying more mainline content means more world? ? We've publicly said that new mainline quest content will be coming out episodically, so you will be seeing episodes of new content, whether or not, you know, 3, 15, however many episodes it takes, essentially becomes a new world's worth of content.
Yes,
it's we gotta wait for the game to be made.
We're not at the scope of team size to build worlds like Wizard. That, like, we just, and we shouldn't take from Wizard is, you know, the bread and butter of the company, but we are scrappy enough that we can take assets from them to make cool content, and, you know, we are making content the size that the team can support right now. So that is the episodic stuff. Maybe it'll add up to be a full world eventually. But yeah, like, for now, we're doing this until we can support the size of a team that would be needed to make a world. If we choose to do that. But no new worlds right now. Let's just say that.
Will we be exploring new places?
I mean, we always want to take you somewhere new. So that's more, again, that's more of a narrative question. But, you know, we always want to give you new avenues to experience stuff, or experiencing things you've already been to, but in different ways, potentially. So that's, you know, I'll say it that way. It's pretty open-ended, but, you know, we're still figuring stuff out.
I saw a question for me, but if I could introduce a Wiz character into Pirate, what would it be? And if I could, I think the gods of Aquila, where we interact with them, the actual gods as wizards, but as the pirate, we just interact with their statues pretty much. We just talk to them through intermediaries or through, like, prophecies and stuff. It'd be interesting if the pirates actually got to meet the Aquilan gods, and to see how that dynamic would be a little bit different between how the wizards interacted with them versus how the pirates would interact with them.
Someone mentioned something about team up's been discussed. We need to see if we can physically do it, but I know it's something, like, it's on our radars, so team up is a thing that we have talked about. It's just, can we physically do it is a thing. So, but I know I have a task to look at it eventually, so get back to it.
Make Merle Ambrose a companion. The visceral gut reaction.
Make a mini Ambrose.
Yeah, make him a pet. Mm-hmm. Make a tiny Merle Ambrose a pet.
Yeah, sure. scale options are a thing. Let's scale stuff down. Make everything a pet.
When you consider naming one of your children based off something Wizard 101. No, but I did commission a tattoo from, oh gods, I hope I say her, her name right. Napiopia, who is one of my favorite artists of all time. I commissioned a piece of art from them that has Hocules. I can actually show it off, can I? Well, that's massive. Commissioned a piece of art from them that's going to become a tattoo that you may recognize one of the characters from this cool game called Pirate 101 on there. Napiopia, you are a legend.
That's cool.
Yeah. So I wouldn't name one of my children Hocules.
But I would probably get a tattoo before naming one of my kids.
Yeah. I mean, you've already
granted, got it. I named one of my kids after an anime character, so I don't know, maybe. So, not my one kid.
To be fair.
Not going to talk about that anymore. Any more questions?
Hocules, you mean my firstborn?
It'll be a real popular name at the daycare.
I mean, Hawk is a pretty cool name. I've seen it as like I've met someone whose nickname was Hawk, and I was like, that's objectively kind of cool.
We get a rename potion like Wizard has. I like the potion stuff that Wizard has. It's something I would like to see more of. So, you know. I like those features.
Sorry,
maybe.
You've been coming along. It's coming along well. There was a hint that was given in the newsletter was the letter T. So they were asking, how's that coming along? So it's coming along. I think you guys will really enjoy it.
So Black Annie, has nothing in terms of drops. Is there something we could get from her?
I mean, I could look at the drop table.
Yeah, her drop table is a little... I doubt
you mean, like, literally nothing. I think you mean stuff that's useful. So
her drop table is a little lackluster for being an Obsidian endgame boss whose namesake is an amazing character.
So, I guess I can say something like that. Our release cadence is gonna probably mimic last year's, so we'll try to do similar stuff. But really, it's like with planning releases for our products, we need to be aware of the other games going on as well. So we don't want to, like, you know, because we have shared assets, we don't want to release something at the same time. Like we share a QA department. So for example, so if we need to test something, you know, we need to schedule out basically around both games. So like Wizard will schedule it around us, we'll schedule it around Wizard. So I would look to do a similar release cadence as last year. So that's what we'd like to hit. We really liked having that last December month to do some like quality of life bug fixing. So I might want to do that next year. But we like to keep the same schedule if we can. We'll change it if it warrants different. But you can look towards that potentially if you're looking for when stuff's going to potentially come out.
One of Artie's big directives for Pirate was regular releases again to show that the game is active and in active development. Yeah. So yes, we plan on doing regular content releases.
Yes. Yeah. Yeah. At a pretty good rate, so we've got those set in stone. It's just for figuring out like what other stuff can we squeeze into the schedule, which always gives suggestions for anything y'all would want. We'll try to do what we can.
What's a moment in Pirate 101 story that you really enjoy? Out of redacted word nowhere, the mech fight.
Yes. Absolutely. I'm going to agree with Hocules, but I'm going to provide a different answer too. But yes, the Stupendor X fight was just a spectacular moment when you come up to this quest and you go fight the Stormzilla in pretty much a Power Ranger Zord. It was great. Mm-hmm. Another favorite part of the story that I really enjoy was the first time you enter into Marleybone Skyway. and you just see the devastation that you caused, and it's great.
I love the how, like, Lisa, I've recently become an orphan. Do you have anywhere I could stay? Here's a ship. Now go cause international diplomatic problems.
I've been reading a lot of like detective stuff lately, so like kind of like the Marleybone stuff with Minecraft Homes. That stuff's kind of interesting to me. So I've been enjoying that a lot lately. But yeah, there's like, you know, there's a lot of great moments throughout the game. Mm-hmm. I like when you get your first ship. I think it's fun and exciting. It's cool. Like so I want that to be better. Like I really want that to be epic. I think that moment's awesome. But we've been doing a lot of cool stuff this last year, so I'm kind of proud of all of those. So those kind of stick pretty heavily with me for moments.
Mm-hmm. Cool Ranch is the best world. It's got yeehaw energy. And I'm from Texas. Yeehaw. Why are the ships only level 65 at max? What's up with that? It's your fault.
That might be a good Ratbeer question.
That would be a good Ratbeer question. I'll have to ask Ratbeer,
yeah. There's a reason why it sticks at that.
Oh yeah, people want a level 70 raft, and I actually agree with them.
That's a good idea.
Level 70 ships, though, so I'm a little bit confused at that question.
I'll go make a Jira for it real fast.
I don't really know what kind of new world. So someone asked if you tasked with creating a new world in Pyro 101, what kind of concept would it be? I don't know. I really want to take Novus from Wizard. We have no plans to do that right now, but I like the style of that world, so I think it'd be cool. But you know, like it would be mostly on narrative to decide. I know that there's like the background story of like what's going on in Pirate. I think having a world based off some of that stuff would be cool. But yeah, it's like, that's like what's important for narrative. Where do we want to go? What stories do we want to tell? That's kind of where like the world would dedicate, but we're not making a new world right now. So.
Limes, there's a good chance that if you're asking, will there be more products coming out this year, there's a good chance that the product team will be making more. I'm not sure about bundles, but you'll get more opportunities to purchase.
There's stuff in the works. There's stuff in the works, yeah.
Yes. Crap. Oh, I shouldn't have read that out loud, but...
Close.
I got caught. Will the difficulty of Sinbad be lowered because it's too hard for solo player and the difficulty curve seems unreasonable like a cliff? Yes, it will be. Initially, Sinbad Part 3 was designed for like players at the end game and players who've been sitting on top tier gear, top level companions, everything. They've been sitting on this for years and years, so the combat was designed to challenge them, but I'm going to be going back in there and adjusting it downwards so that more casual players can get through it. Going to like the Floating Dutchman and stuff, that's not going to change because that's an Obsidian Key bosses, and it's the expectation that Obsidian Key bosses are a lot harder than the regular content. But yes, for Sinbad Part 3, I wanted to do it. Start out with, hey, give the players who have been here and who have like all the stuff an actual decent challenge for them to run through, and then I'm going to go in and revise that back down so that more casual players can get through it.
Like
oh my gosh, Pirate 101 does have a TikTok and a Discord. That's crazy. Someone ban the spammer. Goodness gracious.
Trying to read questions here. Please stop spamming. There was one that directed at Dom that I wanted to read, but I can't find it now. Thanks a lot.
Ban the spammer.
Yeah.
Kyle's in chat. Hey Kyle, how you doing? Freaking love my
backpack space is really tight. Okay, I'll look at it.
Oh yeah, the whole every time you finish a fight you get thrown like 8 to 20 objects, and it's really difficult to trash the objects because a lot of them aren't trashable, and selling the objects is a whole thing. Into. Quick sell.
It'd be nice to have features like that.
It would be.
That's been something that I've been talked about for a while. Something to tackle. Yeah, it's on our radar. We'll look at it again. Maybe we could do something about it.
Please.
Wrote down.
Max gold would probably be, that's a more of an economy question. So if we get Artie on stream, you'd probably talk to Artie about that more so.
Yeah, Artie and Redbeard have answered that question a few times. I think they're of the mind that they would like to first give us more things to spend gold on and more reasons to spend gold.
We need to reassess the value of gold and just to see, like, you know, if we are currently have like too many easy passives to get it, or you know what the proper drain rate should be of it. So you know we probably needed to do some changes to the economy with it. It's kind of in a weird state right now, which we should probably fix.
Classical Cat would like to know, could we add a feature like in Final Fantasy Roman numerals where old max level vets can earn reward and badges for helping new players out? I know we do have one badge for helping new players out through the team up, but that is a pretty genuinely good question. Have we thought about features and mechanics that reward veterans for helping out newbies?
I haven't looked into any in particular. I don't know.
Yeah, it's not something that's necessarily. It's an idea. Like it's something that require a lot of work. You have to gauge will people actually, you know, do it. I know that mobile. That's a really great way to get people back into mobile games.
Mm-hmm.
Invite your friend, get them in. You know, do different stuff. So maybe we could do something with that. Like you know, set amount of times you play with this individual after you've invited them, then you get bonuses, but for the greater, larger response to players, you know, it makes it easier. It does make it so you have a higher chance of getting a player to come in and spend more time in the game, yes. But for a larger group, I don't know if it's necessarily the right system to be investing in. It's like, but it's something, you know, we'll that's a good idea. I'm gonna bring it up in our next meeting.
Laughing Tomb, who must have played old school RuneScape, asks, will there ever be teleportation runes added so you can teleport to specific areas?
That's an interesting question. We could consider it. Like, Wizard has that too. So, they're talking about like teleporters within the same zone, pretty much. It's for like so those big zones that you have to walk all the way through. Uh-huh.
You said to me, yeah, it would maybe, that's one of the things that I hear it and I'm like, maybe that would be too hard. But you know, we've been bit by that in the past, so we have to make sure that it's like not going to be more difficult than it is, and that it's really warranted in the game.
Sorry, y'all. Every time I take a screenshot, the Windows notification thing is going off.
I was wondering. I thought that was my computer. I was like, what's going on?
Sorry, y'all.
I saw a question directed at me earlier that was like, which is my favorite piece of content that I worked on. Probably the Floating Dutchman. I really enjoyed like going back to that fight and like researching how the combat triggers were set up, because cheats are how you guys refer to it, but like cheats in Pirate 101 are set up way, way different than how they were set up in like Wiz. Like in Pirate, they're in like all different areas. So to like backwards engineer it and to try and replicate it onto a max level boss was a really interesting challenge. And I also did some experimental things, which I want to do some more experiments with the battle board, with just putting a line across the center of the battle board. Like, how would that impact combat? Like, how would someone like a Buccaneer deal with it? Would they have to teleport? Would they have to get a teleport item? Would they have to carry companions that have jump and fly? So some experiments will work, some won't, but I like doing like experimental content to see like how we could push the boundaries of the combat system with how we have. Because I think one of the things that Pirate as a tactical game doesn't have a lot of is it doesn't have a lot of different battle board types. Like there's not a, like you'll sometimes see like traps and obstacles on the battle board, but that's to the extent of it. But I'd like to create like different types of battleground types where you have to have different movement types and different ways to navigate it and stuff like that. So I really enjoyed the Floating Dutchman in terms of just researching how to do it, how to implement it, and pretty much for the potential that it opens up for the future.
Yeah. I've got another one I kind of want to enter. So this guy said, because Hocules called me out for liking Eve, which, you know Eve is fine. Like, it's got very interesting stories that come out of it. Will Pirate get a cargo transport system in the future? You know, this is actually something, there's actually old design docs of cargo transport systems that were initially intended for Pirate. So it's something, you know, we look at, we're like, could we potentially implement something like this? It's just, it has a warrant, a feature to be good enough for the health of the game. So it is something we're curious about. Should we do it is the question of like, or should we focus on something else? Like, should we focus on Patooey, or should we focus on, another skeleton keep off or something? It always comes down to that. Like, what's the priority for the product right now to make it more healthy? So that is something we've thought about, though. I've been approached by many people talking about a cargo-based system internally. So it does sound like a cool idea, but it's just like, is it warranted at the time?
Yeah, I see a lot of questions like that. Like, can we add this system or that system? And this would be interesting. And like, I want to answer yes to all of that, but we're a very small team. So we have to prioritize the things that'll have the most impact and be best for the game first. Like, obviously I'd love to do a lot of the things like a lot of people are saying, and I feel kind of bad. Like, we're not really focused on that right now, but that's kind of how it goes with a small team right now. We have to prioritize certain things.
I love one of my first interactions with one of our great engineers was like, I asked him a question about, it was either related to the game or related to something random. And literally the first thing they said was like, have you seen this doc about the cargo system? Like, can you read it so we can maybe think about it? And I was like, I would love to do this, but we don't necessarily can't. And then literally, like, I think I had another question, like with another engineer, like a day later, and they're like, have you seen this cargo doc? I'm like, yes, I've seen it. Like, we can't really do this right now, but I love the enthusiasm. So that'd be cool. But yeah, we would love to do stuff like that. We just need to make sure it's held right for the game. Believe me, Rapier is not bugging me about cargo. I definitely, that's all Rapier talks to me about is cargo. Sure. Yeah. That's not a Rapier system at all, as far as I know. I'll go bring it up to him. Fishing, we need to have a justified reason to get fishing in the game. So no fishing thoughts right now. That does make sense in Pirate that there'd be fishing, but...
Yeah,
but, no.
Like, thematically.
No fishing right now. I haven't thought about that for a while. I'll write it down as a potential idea.
I have to be careful before reading these names now since I got caught with that one.
Yeah, I'm not going to. That's why I stopped reading names. I don't want to butcher someone's name. because I hate that when someone does that to me. Yeah. But also, you know, like you gotta be careful.
Books Broadway 99 says, any plans for quests in worlds we haven't explored a lot yet? That's one aspect we're exploring. Like, we're thinking about, hey, how can we like expand the content without necessarily like getting a huge amount of art assets and stuff. So that's something we consider. And not only that, how can we expand the content, but are there interesting stories to tell in those areas? And we'd have to talk with narrative and writing and all that to figure that out. But it's interesting potential, and the potential is definitely there for it.
Good point to Tim I.
Dragonspire stuff would be cool. No current plans, but you know, we're always thinking about it.
Is Pirate 101 trending in the right direction to bigger and better things? Unequivocally, yes.
Yes.
We did very well last year for the game for a while. I was
very happy with the numbers I saw.
From the history we've done, like, and because we brought me over from Trove, and from you know, we had some additions to the team where people were more focused on different parts of it. We had Dom doing great stuff for character stuff. We did lose some people that would have probably, you know, that would have helped us more. But at the end of the day, things have been, it was a much better year last year. So we want to keep that momentum, keep it going better. So that way we can, you know, grow the team. That is our current goal. So we want to try to figure out ways to improve it. That's why we're talking about doing potentially stuff with population. Maybe we've been wanting to tackle the Patui for a long time because we're worried it's, you know, hurting the game potentially. So, you know, we're having these conversations about these things. Like, what are ways we can, you know, make people excited for Pirate again? We can get them to see, you know, an email and actually click on it. Like, that's what we want. So, but we have been doing better, which is great.
That remaking a game onto a new engine is a gamble that your current game without any development resources will be stable and profitable enough to have a team of developers work on a project that won't see the light of day for years.
Yeah, it's very hard to move engines. Usually when companies do it, they'll get a separate company to come in and do it for you. And then that way you can still do development. It is not something you can probably do with Pirate right now.
Especially with another game like Wizard or Pirate, there's that would be hard pressed to transfer onto a new
don't game. Function the same. They have different, you know, they have just different things that have just aged differently. So they have like UI systems that are just not standard. So UI wouldn't transfer. You'd have to completely rebuild it. Yes, you have all the assets, but still, that's, you know, it takes a long time to do development, especially when you're starting out from scratch, which is essentially what you have to do in that case. Yeah, Unreal Pirate. I would love to be in the Unreal Engine, but we have a pretty good engine for what specifically Pirate does and what Wizard does. It's been made for that. So it's good at doing content in that. We would like to do so someone asked what do you guys think of adding daily rewards each day for accomplishing daily tasks. It could be incentive for people to be more active towards loyalty rewards. I think these systems are great. I've been wanting this since day one. It's something, you know, we have to warrant doing it, of course, like most of my answers are right now. But I think, you know, a daily incentive system is always great to keep players engaging with the game. That's not necessarily our problem right now. We need to get more people into the game. But I think it is a really great way, once you get people in to these products, to keep them incentivized to stick with them. So either doing this or daily events, those are things we've talked about in the past. So if we can get time to do them, I would like that. That'd be awesome. Because that from my past product work, those are always great systems to have. There's just something you can do to get people up slowly and, you know, keep them engaged.
Might be no seeing current. Something interesting on stream if you want to go and find it. And Realm Vadima Aquila Ilios has got some Armada invasion happening.
Pirate battle pass plans. No current pirate battle pass plans, but if it's warranted to do something, if players like that, we can always think about it. But we're not doing battle pass stuff as of right now.
Why can you play Wiz fine on Mac and not Pirate? Because Apple decided to make their processors weird, and I'm sorry, but I could probably count on three people's hands the number of people that play Pirate on Mac. It is just not worth our time or resources.
Yeah. They're different systems, so you have to allocate resources to develop on them to function on them on separately. So you know, I don't know the exact issue with Mac on Pirate. I could look into it, but I'm guessing it's just, you know, yeah, they stopped allowing us to be on, or they stopped letting us function on there well, and we need time to apply fixes for it, which is not in our priority for Mac right now. Maybe it'll change.
Macs are not real.
That's not. I don't agree with that statement, but they're a thing.
Agree to disagree.
I mean, I'm a PC fan too. I've had Macs, but I can't use a Mac anymore. But you know, there are people who still play stuff on Mac. They have good chips. They have good chips, right? I think. We're not currently doing anything to this, but will unused areas in Valencia Part 2 ever be implemented? You know, not right now. We're not thinking of using it right now, but, you know, if we have an unused area, it's something in the toolbox, potentially, we could take out. There's stuff from Wizard, or there's stuff that we have. As long as it's the correct size for the product, we can potentially put something. So maybe we'll use it.
It's all lies. Everything you've ever seen is all lies.
Hey, stop looking over there.
Game developers are lying to you. None of this actually exists.
I didn't put buildings in over there. What are you doing?
All of this is fake.
Yeah. I don't know what command you're using. I'm curious now. I need that command list.
Let's not put that in the chat.
Yeah, I'll put that in the side chat.
People have, like, I've noticed, because the game is so dated, everyone has their own interesting ways of navigating in it. So, like I would be talking to, you know, a previous designer about, like, okay, what's the best way to get through quests? And he can tell me one way. And then I would go read ancient documents and find, like, this secret, like, cheat that someone put in at one point. And then I was just doing it to speed through a quest. And Chris was like, what are you doing? Like, how are you teleporting everywhere? I'm like, I don't know. I just found this thing. So it's just, like, that's, like, the interesting thing of, like, having a game that's so dated, like Pirate, that's 10 years old. You just find stuff that's just, like, gold sometimes with implementing content. But then it could be the opposite way of like, oh, and then you're hitting your head against it because it's hard to develop on sometimes old systems that are like this. But I think we're doing a pretty good job. I'm pretty happy with how we're going.
I have asked about giving content creators or people in general access to the free cam, and the answer was a resounding too much time, too much
no.
effort. And they would spend all this time looking at how ugly the backgrounds are when you break bounds. And we would never want to show those.
Yeah, we don't want to. I mean, I don't know why you're showing them right now. like what are you doing, man?
I'm showing them what game design really looks like. And it's all about being clever.
New badges in the game. Did we add new badges last year? I thought we did.
Yeah, we added for defeating a certain amount of like the flow.
We're still thinking about it. Yeah, we're still thinking about badges. That's a thing that comes up. And I think maybe we can do some for this year. I don't think those require a super lot of work. Right.
I saw a PvP question, like will PvP be fixed? We'll work on bugs that affect PvP, but right now PvP isn't the focus. Right now, like I said, we're focused mainly on expanding the player base and so on. But that's not to say we don't care about PvP. It's just, like I said, it's a matter of prioritization. Like, if we could do all the things, we would. But right now, we really need to focus on expanding the player base. That's the big one. But yes, we will be looking into like bugs for PvP and certain like things that might be overpowered or underpowered or whatnot. We'll be looking into that. But any type of like big revamp to PvP is not on the books at the moment.
Like, people keep asking what our plans are for New Worlds and New Arcs. We've kind of answered that a lot already, so. You know, if the game warrants it, yeah, but we don't have the team size to do it. So, but we'd like to. But there will be new story stuff. So, no worries. I didn't mean to out someone. Sorry, I feel really bad now.
Rose, that's actually something Dom has been slowly working towards. Unique condition encounters.
Yep. Like I said, a lot of the battle board stuff I'm really researching, and I'd love to be able to do like stuff like there's fights where, you know, you have to hit a certain trigger or something. Like, maybe, like, this is pie in the sky stuff. Like, this is not confirmed coming, but maybe you have to defeat a certain enemy that unlocks a different section of the battle board that you can then access to get to the actual objective. Maybe we could have multiple objectives. Maybe you have to do step A first, then step B. So there's a lot of potential there.
Will episodic story updates come with bite-sized level increases? You know, it's something we were talking about actively. Like, should we or shouldn't we raise the level cap? Raising level cap has a ton of things associated with it. So it's kind of like we have to warrant a good reason why we should raise it. And we are in debates about it, but yeah, Dom, you can probably chime in better on this.
Yeah, not just the reason. It's just you wouldn't want to just expand the level cap and not necessarily provide content. So we'd have to look into like having a decent sized chunk of content in order to support a level increase. And that also has implications on like powers and you don't want to, like, I don't know how to put this, but you don't want to do it halfway. You don't want to be like, oh, you're level 75, but you don't have new powers. Your talents didn't increase. Nothing happened. It's just the number went up.
We want to make sure you do it right. Yeah, we want to do it, but we want to do it the right way. And so right now we don't have a good way of doing it the right way. So we shouldn't do it unless we're ready to do it like the way that's best for the game.
Oh my gosh, my favorite artist, Napiopia, is in the chat. What's up? How you doing? Did you see that I showed off the tattoo that you designed for me? I know this is suddenly a very one-way conversation. Sorry.
Someone asked, maybe two larger updates instead of three smaller updates this year. Yeah, we would like to keep some cadence similar last year of like doing kind of somewhat large updates or somewhat, you know, a steady set of updates throughout the kind of four quarters of the year. We have talked about potentially like what if we detract from one to make something a little bit bigger, but that's like very early talks. But at the end of the day, my worry is like we'll do that and then we'll disappear for a couple months and people will be like, what's going on? Where'd everybody go? So there's some pros and cons to doing that, is what I'm trying to say.
Yeah, like I said, one of Artie's big thing is a regular cadence, because we want to show people that, you know, the game is in active development. It's actively being worked on. It's not an abandoned product. It's not like on life support or whatever. It's actively being grown, actively being worked on. And so we want a regular cadence of things for, and it also helps with player retention, of course. We want the players who are here to have interesting and fun things to do so they can keep being here, while we also want to bring in new players and bring back those players that have lapsed.
Ooh, all right. Last 10 minutes of the stream. Dom, Andrew, are there any topics remaining that you want to talk about specifically before we start wrapping things up?
Not particularly. I think we got some good stuff out of this. I'm really excited.
Yeah,
I've been taking notes, so but no, I think this is great. I would like to keep these up, or to at least to, you know, we want to keep Pirate on Twitch this year to engaging with people, so having this just chatting is great.
And I saw a question before, is there other developers that like straddle Wizard and Pirate, and like, yes, like I said, we pull other developers from Wizard to work on Pirate as well. We have an amazing team of people that are dedicated to both games. So yes, there are other people in the background as well that also work on both projects, or we'll grab them for a few if we can and stuff like that. So
yeah, I think besides me, everyone kind of floats. So it's you have to be very fluid to work at KI right now. Be able to work with lots of different people. So It's been great.
If you enjoyed this stream and are thinking to yourself, boy howdy, I'd really like to see a lot of other developers stream on a nearly weekly basis, I got good news. This very account will be streaming a lot more often in the year of our gamer 2024. We'll have these developers, Andrew and Dom, other developers, folks from around King's Isle will be hosted. We'll have specific topics. We'll have general Q&As. We'll jump into the game and spawn random things for Pirate 101. So make sure you hit that follow button. Subscribing will do nothing but signal that you really like what we're doing. Make sure to join our Discord. That's discord.gg/pirate101. Spam in the chat. Thank you all so much for watching,
Coming, guys, and for the great questions. It was a lot of fun.
This is great. Yeah.
Heck yeah.
You know, it's always fun to actually engage with like the players and these forums where you can actually release information or just talk about stuff in general, like do's and don'ts, what we can't do and what we can do. So I think this has been really great. So we've got a lot of good stuff out of it. So thank you, everybody.
Yeah. All right. Well, that's been our time. I'm Hocules. That's Dom and Andrew, Pirate 101 developers. If you'd like to say thank you or say hello, they will occasionally pop into the Pirate 101 Discord.
They still need to come up with a name for me.
Yeah, chat, come on.
At some point. I know people were originally saying Captain Blood.
Captain Blood.
For a while. Because I was talking about like vampire stuff, and like vampires and other things, but like, I don't know. Pick a name. Someone name me. So.
Captain Swing, not Captain Swing. Blood.
Captain Swing. Who's I need to look up that character. Mitch Miracle. Miracle Mitch. Yeah,
Miracle,
sure.
Miracle Mitch is a good one.
Yeah.
This game has load-bearing references to other NerdCon. All right. Ladies, gentlemen, and all the other fantastic flavors of human beings in between, thank you so much for joining. This has been your Pirate 101 Developer Q&A stream. Hope you have a fantastic weekend. And be careful out there this weekend. It's going to get cold.
Oh, yes. I think it's going to hit the 30s, right?
Mm-hmm. Ladies, gentlemen, smalls, mediums, and larges, have a good weekend. Bye.